对。
Cholera, also known as HIV cholera, is a disease caused by the bacteria Vibrio cholera. Vibrio cholera, a little bit more about the structure of Vibrio cholera. It is a bacteria with a highly motile. They have highly motile curved rods with a single polar frenulum. Cholera is a waterborne disease which mainly affects countries that have no proper sanitation. Now, cholera is caused by, is when we ingest the bacteria Vibrio cholera, which is found in contaminated water and not properly cooked food. Now, contaminated water is found in, is caused by untreated sewage which enters our water supply, and this is this, and when we ingest this water or drink water, the bacteria enters our system and we get the disease cholera. Now, the result of this ingestion is diarrhea, which is also a way of how the disease spreads, but it's rarely, this disease rarely spreads from person to person. Now, the typical symptoms of this disease is very watery and cloudy looking diarrhea.
Oh my god.
Vomiting and electrolyte imbalance.
Since everybody needs water, like,
problems are really big popular, especially when there are natural disasters like earthquakes, where water supplies are water supplies like tanks and water and stuff are broken, then that's like one small part of bacteria can easily grow out to like millions of people, everybody will get infected. So these are just some examples of outbreaks that occurred quite recently. And the first recorded outbreak of cholera was in the Ganges River in 1817 in India. And so Haiti and South Sudan, there's like a correlation in the most developing countries. Alright, mechanisms of... Okay. The Vibrio cholerae enters the body through contaminated food and drinks, and it passes through the stomach and it colonizes the small intestine. During colonization, the bacteria actually just reduces in number because the stomach acid found in the stomach. And then if the more resistant bacteria survives and the weaker ones die. So the more resistant bacteria sticks to the intestinal epithelial cells found in the small intestine. Or you can just say the intestinal mucosa, if you want to be more scientific with it. And the bacteria doesn't actually penetrate the mucosa. It's very lazy. It just kind of secretes a toxin called cholagen. And the toxin does all the work. Oh yeah, and the bacteria multiplies rapidly. The toxin binds to the intestinal receptors in, and one subunit enters the cell and activates an enzyme called ethylamidic cyclase. Now this is very important. The activation of this enzyme actually increases the chloride secretion and impairs the absorption of sodium by the virus cells. So large amounts of sodium and chloride are released into the intestine. Now water moves the electrolyte and this leads to profuse water loss. So this actually can cause diarrhea and vomiting, the usual symptoms of cholera. Okay, now there are a few things to say. Okay, vomiting and diarrhea persists, this can lead to severe dehydration. Now, severe dehydration can cause multiple organ failures and, of course, you will die. Technically, that's it. There's actually treatment for this, but it's not actually my part. I can elaborate later, but just a side note. Because of the electrolyte imbalance, you might have to take oral dehydration therapy to actually restore the imbalance and make it balanced. So, yeah, moving on.
Okay. So it's actually very easy to treat cholera disease. It requires immediate treatment because it can cause bad in our life. For the treatment, we have dehydration, where it is to replace lost fluid and electrolyte by using simple dehydration solution, which is known as ORS. So basically, all you need to do is mix water with salt and sugar and drink it. And for next treatment, it's called as intravenous fluid, which is IV drips. IV drips function the same as dehydration, but it's to replace lost fluid as well. But then the difference is it's actually directed to the brain. So for antibiotics, it's not necessary, but the drugs reduce both the amount and duration of cholera-related diarrhea. For zinc supplement, it works best for children, but it's to shorten the duration of diarrhea in children. For prevention, we have vaccine. There's two types of vaccine. The first one is called Bucorol is actually qualified by WHO and it's licensed over 60 countries. For Sanchol, it's actually licensed in their way, but the qualification is still pending. Vaccine is two-dose vaccine. You take multiple ways before a person receiving vaccine are protected. It is available vaccine for protection for a relatively short period of time. So this CDC and WHO, which is World Health Organization, don't really recommend this vaccine. But then, when you guys travel to the country where there's cholera disease, it's better for you to get vaccine beforehand. So drink and use safe water. Boil it or treat it with boiling product. If for boiling, drink your water to complete boil for at least 1 minute. And always store clean water in covered containers. And wash your hand often with soap before eating your food or preparing your food, and also before feeding your children. And remember to wash your hand after using the toilet. And this is the correct way to wash your hands. So for step one, you guys just rub with cleansing agent, rub your hand in a circular motion. Then interlock it, so rub it in this way. And do the front of each hand like this. And use the monkey grip according to this is called monkey grip. And rub it this way. And just rub it on the right thumb area. And just push it. And remember to cook food well. It is important to cook your food well, especially people like what Shina has seen in the screen, because like you guys stuff, yeah. So keep my oven and plate hot. It is important also to be cook the food until it is hot all the way through, especially seafood. And avoid eating raw food other than vegetables.
Leader.
Now let's discuss other things about cholera for rural perspective. Okay, so now let's look at the countries affected by in Asia, mainly the South Asia, like South Asian countries like Afghanistan and Bangladesh are affected by cholera. In Southeast Asia, Philippines is the most stable country that experiences cholera outbreaks. In the West and East Africa is also prevalent. Cholera is also prevalent in these regions because, as compared to other parts of Africa like the South and the North parts, these two parts are a little less developed compared to the other regions of Africa. And also a notable region in the Caribbean with cholera is Haiti, which experienced a recent outbreak, quite recent in 2010, following an earthquake. We will be discussing that later on, but generally, areas that are vulnerable to cholera have poor sewage treatment. They also have lack of clean water, and due to the lack of clean water, people may actually resort to using their own sewage to water their vegetables and crops, so which spreads the cholera further. So in history, there have been several outbreaks, the first six of which occurred between the 1800s and the 1900s. This was due to the high human population at that time, because it followed the Industrial Revolution, so there was a sudden increase in human population. The cities were unable to keep up with this increasing human population in terms of sanitation, so that's how the cholera spread rapidly. And the strain that caused this is known as cholera 1, or also called the classical strain. And this outbreak killed millions of people across the globe. So the seventh and current outbreak is caused by L4, a new strain of cholera, relatively new. It was first discovered in Indonesia in 1961, made its way northwards, and within 12 years it made its way into Europe, and in 1991 it reached the Americas. Now one reason why it spread so rapidly was the habit of ships to expose their sewage directly into the ocean and infect aquatic life. So now we are faced with the daunting fact that there is a possibility for an eighth outbreak. The eighth outbreak might, the possibility of an eighth outbreak could possibly be caused by a new strain known as Vibrio cholera 0139. Now why it's very, why this strain seems to be more dangerous is because it took L4 2 years to displace the classical strain in India, but this new strain took only 2 months to which makes the air prostrate, so that's why you want to do it. And on top of that, people who have previously contracted cholera did not acquire immunity to the menstruate, so that's a very scary fact. So social implications of cholera, we will be looking for the Peru. So Peru had an outbreak in 1991. It was the reason it started in the coastline and made its way inwards, like it started from the beach areas, people started getting infected there, and it made its way inwards. And the theory that has been attributed to the way it spread was the sewage dumped the ships dumped their sewage into the ocean. Some of the sewage may have contained the cholera bacteria, and the cholera bacteria infected aquatic life. And when you catch this aquatic life and use it as cook it and eat it as seafood, you would effectively put yourself at risk at contracting cholera. So that's how the people in Peru contracted the disease. So when this was discovered, Peru was subjected to embargoes, which means that people did not want to trade with Peru, especially for the seafood, because they feared they would contract the disease. And on top of that, people were very afraid to visit Peru, which caused them to grow. And as a result of both of these, Peru lost more than $700 million in terms of their revenue. Haiti, as mentioned before, in January of 2010, there was an earthquake. The earthquake destroyed infrastructure in the country, and the infrastructure particularly affected was the sewage system. And when the sewage system is critically destroyed, they were unable to remove the sewage effectively. As a result, the disease spread 10 months later very rapidly to 8,000 people, and those who are still alive, the 6% have already contracted the disease. And the reason why, another reason why it spread rapidly was, it was thought that the disease made its way into the Arbomac River, the largest river in Haiti, and used by the rural people as drinking and washing people. So the related disease is typhoid, and it's also caused by bacteria. It also causes diarrhea, but your diarrhea also causes hemorrhage, which is the opposite of diarrhea, which means you cannot poop. It's very difficult. The thing about typhoid, I think it's worse because if you freeze it, let's say your food is frozen, right? It can actually stay alive in a dormant state, and let's say you cook your food, it is reactivated so-called and can actually infect you. So that's why in developing countries and developed countries like US, it's actually quite prevalent, but not very, it's not an outbreak, so it's outbreak sort of thing, like just as they increase. So yeah, these are one of the symptoms, but it's not as bad as AIDS or like, so trichuriasis is also similar to cholera, but it's caused by a worm instead of a bacteria. And on top of diarrhea, you also get blood coming along with that, diarrhea, which is very disgusting and no pictures in the And let's say you lose so much blood through your feces, you might have long-standing blood loss, and eventually iron deficiency, anemia, and it's related in warm countries. So, oh wait, that's okay. So these are the ones that I posted specifically. These are actually the ones. So how does cholera invade the immune system? So as mentioned earlier, cholera is very fast. You can actually die of this disease very quickly. Let's say you contract it during breakfast, you could actually die by dinner. So that's one of the things you have to know. It spreads very rapidly, so your body is unable to mount a specific sort of immune response. So what it does is it secretes a very non-antigen specific antibody. It's very general, it's not specific for cholera, and it can bind to most bacteria, including cholera. And in order to bind with the cholera, it needs to have an MHSI phyla. The phyla is like a projection in the bacteria, it's like a flagellum sort of thing. We'll look at that later. And it will cause agglutination, the bacteria will clump together, making it easier for white blood cells to divide. So this is the phyla we were talking about, it's actually meant for adhesion with other bacteria and host cells to infect the host cells easier, it's like to stick on itself. Unfortunately for the bacteria, it allows the secretory IgA to bind with the bacteria. Stands for typhoid mannosomes, and also the bacteria has a TOXT factor. It's basically a gene in the bacteria that can turn on and turn off. It controls two things, the virulence of the bacteria, which is like the speed of which it divides, how fast it divides, and how often it will infect your body cells. And it also synthesizes the synthesis of the pili that I mentioned before. So this is what happens in the TOX detector is that one is not the
antigen. Okay, so basically what happens in this process is the antigen that's present here allows the antibodies to latch on to the bacteria and therefore the mutination occurs, which is the binding of bacteria together, and the white blood cells therefore digest all the bacteria and you get a happy stomach. And this how the gene gets deactivated is basically
it's supposed to be facing here.
Yeah, it's basically how you know how the MHSA gets synthesized, the P gets synthesized? That is a hair which allows the antibody to latch on to bacteria. So without that hair, the antibody cannot latch on and therefore it cannot be digested. And in result, the gene gets deactivated.
No, she doesn't. Okay, so basically this the gene is turned off, right? So remember the pili is not? Yeah, the bacteria doesn't make those. So it's difficult for the antibody to bind the bacteria. So the mutation does not occur. So remember the gene just now, right? Two things. The pili turned off and the bacteria is like it's like hiding up basically. It's like, oh, I'm not here, but actually I'm here, but I'm just hiding. So when it's hiding, your immune system can't actually search for this bacteria. And the pili just now, since it's not there, the MHSA can't bind with the bacteria. And so the bacteria is free to infect your intestinal lining, and as a result, you would probably have a stomach. So this is the references and sources. So there's actually more than one theory how the bacteria invades the immune system, but this is one of the most famous studies so far.
Okay, guys, look. Anyone does reference and sources like this before?
Yeah.
Did you put it any in your PowerPoint?
No.
This is very good. I didn't tell you, but you should know lah. Okay, for future, any presentation that you're doing, any assignments you are doing, any lab reports you are doing, at the back, you need to put your reference and sources. Please remember that. Okay, so good job. I think I like this presentation slides better. It's just certain fonts are quite small. Okay, other than that, I think good. Any questions for cholera? I think it's very direct, straightforward. Okay. I'm not sure whether you answered this question or not, but why our immune system is, you know, unable to fight the cholera, Vibrio cholera?
Because it evades very well.
Because it
evades the bacteria very well.
How it evades the bacteria very well?
Because it occurs so quickly that your body is unable to mount a specific response. Mm. Like it cannot catch the bacteria, cannot make the specific antibody. So what it does is just it secretes a general antibody known as IgG.
So in general terms, what happened basically, your body is very well can respond to the bacteria given a time. The problem is time, okay? Before even your soldier is getting prepped in your body, it takes away your body. It kills your body. So the progression of the disease is faster compared to the immune system. Simple as that. Understand? That's why we give them the oral rehydration therapy and antibiotics. Okay? So good. Let's go for the last presentation for the day. And this group, credit to them, they didn't use normal PowerPoint. So they try a new software. So let's see how does it go. Come.
Yeah.